Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to what promises to be a high energy, nay, a high energy per unit time or power meeting. And it is a great pleasure for me to welcome my friend and old acquaintance, Helge Hove Haldorsen, who comes here from Norway via Mexico and Houston. And Helge has been the last SPE, the outgoing SPE president, Society of Petroleum Engineers president, culminating with the 3-year service, his long years of public service for the industry and the community. Prior to his tenure in Statoil, where he has been a vice president of strategy and portfolio, for Statoil Development and Production North America. Now he's managing the Statoil affairs in Mexico. Haldorsen worked for Norsk Hydro in various roles, including Chief Reservoir Engineer, Vice President of Technology and Competence, Vice President of Exploration and Research, Senior Vice President of International Exploration and Production, and President of Hydro Gulf of Mexico. He also held various engineering positions at British Petroleum, Standard Oil of Ohio, or SOHIO, ExxonMobil, which was Esso at that time. He was a second lieutenant in the Royal Norwegian Navy and professor of industrial mathematics at the University of Oslo. Haldorsen earned an MS degree in petroleum engineering from the Norwegian Institute of Technology and a PhD degree in reservoir engineering from the University of Texas in Austin, from the department of which I had the honor to be a chair for 6 years. But I would be remiss when I just recite all these wonderful achievements if I didn't speak about Helge the man. He is a great human being and a very generous man and a great friend. And he is kind, generous, and a man of great vision. In fact, Helge has contributed very significantly in Statoil's participation in a unique research program at UT, which actually was $1 million per year to spend on students to give them grants to do research on unusual topics. So I would like to thank Helge for this and for coming here and for gracing us with his presence and his speech. Please, Helge.
Thank you, Ted. And good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming. It's such a pleasure and an honor for me to be here, to be invited to talk to such a distinguished audience. The title, you know, is kind of predicting the next 85 years. We can't even predict the next month or the next half year, so this is a tall order. So it's not going to be a paint-by-numbers presentation. So when I finish in 1 hour, you connect the dots and you get something. What I want to do, on the other hand, is to give you maybe a couple of dots that you hadn't thought of, maybe a couple of perspectives or angles that are new to you. And then I want you to connect something in your mind, and then maybe you get something we haven't heard of any of us before. So I'm not giving you a map for the next 85 years, but I hope to give you kind of a compass. What do we navigate after? What type of attitude should we have as we go forward? I'm a big believer in serendipity, and I think serendipity almost is a verb. I think you can create your own luck, you can create your own serendipity if you are curious. And I call connecting dots, that's what I mean when I think of being curious. I was looking at the Coast logo, this beautiful logo that you have, and many of us belong to a tribe, and we stay in petroleum engineering all the time. We don't visit, say, physics and medicine and space. But I think the meaning behind this, maybe somebody can tell me later that this was not the meaning behind the logo. The minute you leave your own tribe and visit and get impulses from other tribes, you are going to do much better in your tribe. So that's going to be kind of the main theme for me, to connect dots, to create serendipity in your mind. So here is this amazing country of Saudi Arabia from an interesting perspective. And the title is a question, how can the industry survive, I put it, the next 84 years to make it 2100, a good round number. And let's give the answer immediately. The way we survive going forward is to have a tremendous imagination. So we have to think of how do we get to be a more imaginative human being? How can Coast, what can Coast do to be the most imaginative and creative campus in the world? Because we need that to come up with new technology that we totally depend on. And then we need to adapt it so that the industry today is called E&P, exploration and production. And we quickly, at these oil prices, have to become E&P 2.0, 3.0, 4.0. It's kind of like from Alexander Graham Bell's first telephone in 1876 to iPhone 6 in our pockets. It never stops. We have to adapt and renew, and this is going to be a main theme. But the oil industry is not just about producing oil and gas. It's also about the way we do it. So I'm going to be talking about how we have to navigate success, not in 3D, but in 4E. And I'll share with you what I think the most important E's are in order for this industry to navigate success. And I'm also going to dare to visit this big question, when do we stop using oil? You know, a pretty fundamental question for Norway, for Mexico, for Saudi Arabia, for the world. So here we go. Let's start with the 4 E's. I said we have to navigate success in 4E. Well, first of all, of course, we have to do what we do in an efficient way. We have to produce enough oil to supply a growing global population. So that's kind of the way we do it. But this is a commercial industry. This is not philanthropy or anything like that. We have to earn money. People invest in our companies if it's not an NOC. So we have to deliver competitive return on investment. We need to have low enough break even so that we survive at low oil prices. That's the economic dimension. And then, of course, more and more what we do has to be in an environmentally sustainable way. We need to maintain the license to operate from the local communities and from the global population. And then finally, how appropriate at Coast, it is about education. As an industry, we have to educate much better and more the public about what we do. We also have to attract the finest minds in the nation and globally, like you, being students here. And then the employees, so for example, Saudi Aramco or Statoil, the education never ends. So these are the 4 E's that I'll be visiting in my talk. So here is an overview of the outline. I'm a history buff. I love history. I always check when I talk what happened on this day in history. So we'll see what I found. And then I'm going to go back to this very grounds here, 12,000 years ago, and discuss on these coast grounds what was going on here. Then I'm going to visit quite a lot what Schumpeter, the Austrian-American economist, called creative destruction, because that's so important for E&P 2.0. Then I'm going to talk about something I really like. I'll talk about the outlook for energy. I'm going to talk about the state of affairs of E&P in 2016. And I haven't checked the news yet, but I think we might have broken the $30 per barrel getting to 29. I'm going to check when I come back. And then I'm going to talk about transitions. And you know, anytime something ends, that's bad for, let's take music on CD discs. There are 50,000 stores selling CDs around the world and 2 million people working there. And then came iTunes and all the stores closed and all the people lost their job, and that's creative destruction. But there's an upside in endings in that case for Apple, of course. I'll talk about that. And then I'm struggling to learn not Arabic, but Spanish. And in Spanish, conclusion is reflexiones finales. And it sounds more intelligent, so I picked that. So I picked this one first. On January 12, 1970, the first 747 made its voyage, maiden voyage, right? Unbelievable airplane. I just flew Mexico, Houston, Frankfurt, Jeddah. It's just unbelievable. But if you go back a little bit to the finest professor of the time, even degrees Kelvin after him, and many of you know what a fantastic scientist he was, he said, I can state flatly that heavier than air flying machines are impossible. I bet he regretted that later, because we know these two bicycle repair guys, they said, well, I'm not sure if he is right. And then, of course, the Kitty Hawk flew on December 17, 1903, proving him wrong. So they, in a way, erased the im in impossible. And this is what we call radical change. This is when you make something that everybody says is impossible, and then you make it possible. So I'm going to talk about many erasing of ims in my presentation. But of course, we're back to impossible if we don't have oil. Ted and I talked about it. This is all fine, but how do we fly without oil? That's another im that we can talk about another time, but pretty important for now. I couldn't have come here if it wasn't for fuel. From airplanes to cars, on this day, Henry Ford had a good time on the frozen Michigan lake, and he set a new speed record, which is nothing impressive today. And the reason I took him and this event was to show you this one, because this is one of the most wonderful quotes that I know. If I asked people what they wanted, everybody would have said, a faster horse, right? We're so stuck in what we do today. It's so hard to make a car, right? But if you make a car when everybody else is making faster horses, that's when you have a competitive advantage. You beat the rest, right? So I think of all the faculties that I visited today, of course we have to do a lot of incremental improvements, you know, because we cannot expect every year to have something unbelievable happen. So steady we go, incremental improvements. But on occasion, you know, we have to do better than a faster horse. We have to come up with something radical. So I think you agree this was, even to get here from just riding to this point, having taxis in London, Hyde Park is a good one with incremental improvements. But then to motorize it and use oil to get going, that is a radical improvement. So you can take almost any product that we use today and we incrementally improve it. Isn't this funny? This is the first mobile telephone in 73. It cost $10,000. It looks like it weighs 15 pounds. But look how proud he is, right, that he can know. And this is a radical thing that you can walk around and hold this telephone. And now, of course, I have one of those, and many of you do. And we're almost not impressed anymore when we have another feature, another app, another Uber. The camera is so good, nobody's buying cameras anymore. Canon is almost going broke like Kodak did a while ago. So this is always a telephone, but improvements never stop. And I think we have a mix of radical and incremental improvements as we go along. And the last one I took was our good friend here that you all recognize. He actually on his way back now from the famous islands, and he went to Sydney, Australia. On this day, he sailed into Sydney. And of course, if you sum up what he said, adapt or else. If the flowers on your island develop a deep throat, so to get to the nectar, if you have a short beak, you are not doing very good. You're going to be finished as a bird on that island, right? And that was via mutation and natural selection. But we don't have time for that. That can take millions of years. We have to do it with creative destruction, as I talked about. So let's define that. But first, this famous quote, it's not the strongest, not the most intelligent, but those most responsive to change. And that's what's happening to our industry right now. We have pressures from all sides that I'll show you, and we have to adapt, and we have to be responsive, and we have to change. So here is then the famous economist who cornered the term creative destruction. And there are many examples of it, but it basically means the process in which technology and innovation create new ways of doing things, and in the process leave the old way behind. So there's a next big thing, and there's a next old thing. And one is happy and one is very unhappy. And we already talked about this one, creative destruction of transport with horse. And then, I don't know about you, but in Houston, when I call yellow cab, I have this Scandinavian thing that you shouldn't drink and drive. In Norway, if you're caught by police, even if after a glass of wine, you go to prison. So nobody kind of in Norway, in their right mind, drinks alcohol and drives a car. So if I go to a function, then I like to take a yellow cab. And of course, they never come. It stinks. It sounds like the engine is not going to make it there because it's out of repair. And compare that now to just hitting Uber, right? and checking how many in the neighborhood, and they come and they smell good and they get us there. I get the receipt in email. Unbelievable creative destruction. In our industry, of course, we have gone deeper and deeper. We've gone to 10,000 feet, 3,000 meters to develop oil fields. And then onshore, the what we call the shale revolution in America, of course, we drill longer and longer wells with smarter and smarter completions and fractures. And then I went to Midland recently and I took a picture out the window. Look at how we have been carpet bombing, you know, the Permian Basin. And this, of course, has added up to 4.5 million barrels a day. And that has taken us over what the world needs, of course, sending the oil price down, that we'll get back to. And of course, this is then the famous shale revolution again, based on technology. But let's go back here again. In the Nafu Desert of Saudi Arabia, just like in the Clovis culture in America, you have flint arrowheads, or arrowheads of some stone in that neighborhood. Beautiful things, and think about it, this was the most high-tech on the planet at that time. There was nothing more high-tech in Australia, in China, in Norway, in Mexico. This was it. This was the most high-tech you had. So here is Ted and me sitting here on these grounds 12,000 years ago. And Ted says to me, Helge, look at that beautiful moon. Notice how you had trees at that time everywhere. Helge, look at that beautiful moon. I wish we could go to the moon. And I said, Ted, are you crazy? We only have flint arrowheads. We can't go to the moon, right? And then, of course, we did, right? 12,000 years later, on July 21, 1969. And I think you agree with me, when you put these two next to each other, this shows what mankind can do, right? All we have is flint arrowheads. It's impossible to think of going to the moon up there, right? And then we do it, right? An unbelievable amount of incremental and radical things making this possible. But to me, this shows what we can do with engineering, with imagination, with passion. George Bernard Shaw, a good man from, I think, Dublin, he co-started London School of Economics, he said, some people see what is and say, why? I dream things that were and say, why not? And this adds up to, for me, what he says in this book, mankind's ability to innovate, adapt and change is maybe the most encouraging and optimistic aspect of human nature, and I agree with him. So to all you students out there, to sum this section up, I think to ask then why not and what if, and don't believe people who say it's impossible, that is the attitude you need to have. And here we have Steve Jobs. I just saw the CNN movie about him again, and I totally agree with what he has quoted here. Nelson Mandela, it always seems impossible until it's done. And this kind of sums up my view that I said initially. This is my Big Bang theory of new original ideas. Life consists of collecting dots one way or the other. I sat next to the president of Coast and he told me something, I got the dot, I talked to Ted, I met two students, and I'm just collecting new stuff all the time. And then I come up with something. And if I just stayed within petroleum engineering, my tribe, I think I wouldn't have enough dots to connect. I'm not original enough. I have to steal from other sciences, from medical, what have you, to come up with something really new. So this is why I'm so passionate about visiting other sciences and disciplines, bringing them together, stealing and what have you. And that also goes for diversity. It's not nice to be diverse on campus and companies and teams. It's a business imperative for these reasons that you see here. And I think the fittest are going to be the most diverse. So this is a wellbore. So now we're homing in on petroleum engineering. But just an example, I read this book by Eric Topol. He should come to the winter series that you have. Unbelievable guy. He's up here with an iPhone 6 and he's measuring 25 things in his body. His pulse, his sugar level. It's just unbelievable, right? And the book is called The Creative Destruction of Medicine, How the Digital Revolution Will Create Better Healthcare. So when I listened to him and read that book, I thought E&P is high tech, but we're nothing compared to how far they've gotten with the internet of everything, with sensors, with feedback loops, alarms. You have a heart attack in 4 days unless you do something. We have a lot to learn from them. Besides, to get the new dot is doing this to you. Man's mind, once stretched by a new idea, never regains its original dimension. Just by learning something new, you change the setup of neurons up there. You're more receptive, think differently about things. Almost done on this section. So if I should define innovation that my industry depends on to improve, it is to make unexpected connection between things. So if you're curious, you know a million things. And then because you're curious, every day you pick up new things. And then, bang, you connect them. And very often the two are not spectacular per se, but when you connect them, you have iPhone and Uber and all these new ideas that we talked about. This one I think I'll skip. We've all been in this one that we have a fantastic idea, but nobody listens to us. This is an interesting paper of a guy who asked 1,000 people who were 65 years old, if you lived your life over again, what would you have done differently? And the number one answer was, I should have taken more risks. So don't be too risk-averse as a professor, as a student, as anything. Stay hungry, stay foolish, he said. He went to Everest. People don't decide to become extraordinary, they decide to accomplish extraordinary things. That's what you have to decide as well. Gary Hamel, the big management guru, this is a wonderful YouTube, and he says that the winners in oil companies, and just about with anything, is to have a passionate crew, lots of creativity, and lots of initiative. You don't wait to be asked. This giant, of course, in science says imagination is more important than knowledge. You have to know Darcy's law, you have to know Maxwell's equation, but that's not enough. If you want to make 2.0, you need more imagination. Look at his office the day he passed away. On Pi, you celebrate Pi Day here, March 14. Look at this. This is a guy who is into lots of stuff, right? Everything we think and dream of is not happening. Star Wars, you know, the Millennium Falcon is not here yet. And he is very disappointed. Many of you know Peter Thiel. We wanted flying cars. Instead, we got Twitter, right? So it takes some time. But the big one is, of course, that the biggest danger is that we have a failure of imagination, that we don't come up with what we need. So a challenge to you is when I come back then in 2062 to the winter program, we have canceled gravity and we finally have flying cars, right? So we have to make the impossible possible in my industry and in many of the things that you work with, but we also have to make the impossible affordable, otherwise it would not be put to use. So this sums up the challenge. The future is not a gift, it's an achievement, and every generation helps make its own future, and that goes for my industry and for all the departments and work that you do. So that was about kind of innovation and how to imagine 2.0. Now we're going to talk about something I like, homing in on the industry. Every day, including today, on January 12, we produce 95 million barrels. That's what we produce today, all together, holding hands. And 350 billion cubic feet of gas. To do that this year, we're going to drill 70,000 wells. Last year we drilled 80,000. This year, because of cut in budget, 70,000. We're investing between this and $1 trillion per year. What is this energy doing that we produce? It's lifting people out of poverty, it's raising living standards, it's fueling human progress. Sometimes we forget that, and we couldn't have done it without you, when you're a part of this industry, or any part of it. And in many ways, you have changing the world for the better in your job description. So what do you do for a living? I change the world for the better. Because the energy I produce in 2016 will lift 150 million people out of poverty this year. There's a book by Simon Sinek called Start With Why. If you do something for a living, it feels good to ask, why do I do this? And if you do something that lifts 150 million people out of poverty, that feels pretty good. If you raise living standards by producing energy, that feels like a good thing to do with your career. And to me, this is very, very important, this element of the passion behind what we do. A book just came out called The Moral Case for Fossil Fuels by Epstein. You know, the industry is heavily criticized for polluting and cartelling, and you know the headlines, and many of you feel as well that this is not a good industry. If you look at the big picture, of course, fossil fuels today, January 12, contributed, I think, more than 85, I read also 87% of the global energy used today. And if you compare that to the alternatives, the overall impact is, of course, to make the world a far better place. I think there is a movie called A Day Without Oil and Gas, and of course we're straight back to the Stone Age, people die in hospitals, we can't travel anywhere, so we're not ready for that. I love renewables, and everybody I work with in oil companies love renewables, but we're not there yet. So today on January 12, solar, wind and geothermal, they contributed less, I think 1.6% of the global energy we use today came from those, even if we love them, all right? So we aren't ready yet, and I'll talk more about that later. So who is producing all this oil and gas? Of course, it's usually NOCs and IOCs and independents, and here, of course, is one major of them, Saudi Aramco. It just so happened that my company is next to them on this one, but we're teaming up and we're doing this. And of course, then some of us are teaming up into what's called OPEC and non-OPEC. And of course, Saudi Arabia has a prominent position in the OPEC production with 10 million barrels of the 30-something that OPEC is producing. But we're at the university campus, so I have to have a quiz in my talk. So here's my quiz. I'm going to be going on with you for 60 minutes tonight. How many new customers of energy net on planet Earth do you think we get in 1 hour? So people pass away, new are born. How many net new customers do you think we get in 1 hour that I speak? 10,000. So that means that I think Saudi Arabia is about 30 million people. So that means that in just 120 days, we're adding 30 million new customers of energy on the planet, right? And that's a huge number. And that's why this plot looks like this. We're now 7.4, I think. And then in 2040, we're going to be 9 billion people. And in addition, the global middle class is lifted out of poverty with the energy that we just talked about. And between these 2 years, we're adding 3 billion people with purchasing power, right? And what do they want? They want the same as us. Heating and cooling and transportation, sending up global demand for hydrocarbons. And I could have taken Shell, Exxon, McKinsey, EIA, there are so many of these, but they pretty much look the same. And this is then the outlook for energy mix globally, and this one is by Exxon, and it goes to 2040. And look at 2040, and look at the prominent place of oil and gas in 2040. It's almost unbelievable. I can't think of almost any other business that has this type of outlook, because it's such a tremendous supertanker to get all this yellow. This is then solar, wind and biofuel. And they disagree. Some has 5%, some has 7, some has 12, some has 15. But it is just a kind of a yellow dot on top in everybody's scenario. Maybe everybody is wrong. This could be the case. And then, as you know, the new black sheep of the fossil fuel family, more than ever, of course, is coal, because it emits so much CO2 per unit heat generated compared to particularly natural gas. So many feel that the orange color will be substituted, particularly with more red. And then, of course, the percentage oil and gas in 2040 is even amazingly big. Of course, in addition, of course, we feel nuclear will grow, maybe difficult to grow, and hydro, biomass. But, you know, this business is going to be here for decades. This is a long-term business, even if you read that we could... I spoke at MIT recently, and a representative for the Sierra Club, a very, you know, a good NGO in America, basically told the students, next Thursday we can run the world on solar, wind and biofuels, right? But this is not the case. I talked to him afterwards, I said, this is almost disinformation. We love renewable, but we aren't ready yet. So what's going to be the bridge then between the high carbon mix we have now and then the low future that the G7 wants us to have? And of course, a club of European IOCs have come out and very strongly saying that natural gas is the bridge. We have to boost the use, and they actually want to introduce a carbon tax. because then, of course, you're going to price out coal because they emit so much that the operating cost is going to kill it. So it's pretty amazing, isn't it, that the club of 10 majors are saying, please, can we have a carbon tax to get an equal playing field? So let's now get to the core of the business that I represent. Let's take the pulse of exploration and production right now. And even if you don't follow this closely, I bet you see the headlines, and being in a very oily country, you can't help but follow the oil price and what's going on. So let's take the pulse. First of all, we had this plummeting oil price, right? We were sailing along at a very wonderful oil price, 100 to 110, and we got lazy and complacent, and we didn't focus on cost and efficiency, and we could afford everything, and cost went higher and higher and higher. And to be honest, even at $110 a barrel in 2011, 2012, the return on capital employed had gone from 25 down to 13% return, which is not very good. So the investors were very unhappy with E&P, even at 110. And then here we go, right? I thought, how can I represent the shocking situation we have? And I took the scream by one of the few famous Norwegian painters, right? Edvard Munch, because this is what it feels like. And I just said earlier that we might have broken the $30 per barrel again today, I'm not sure. But this feels unbelievable. You're used to this type of cash flow, and now you're down here. And we'll talk a little bit about why that happened. And I just took the Economist front page that many of you have read on a weekly basis. And to be honest, OPEC has been churning along at about 30 million barrels a day, like they said they would. But then, of course, shale went from nothing to 5 million barrels a day, and the world didn't need all that new oil, right? So it's become kind of a shake versus shale, they put it in The Economist. But if you look at what we call the cost curve in our industry, this is, if you want to put on one marginal barrel of production more, what does it cost on the average to put that on? And of course, this is Saudi Arabia and the rest of OPEC. And then you go onshore with Russia, then you get to shale, and all the way to oil sands, which are very high break-even. And I think now you have to lift this curve even more, particularly here. So you can then imagine the difference between them. But everybody was used to, if somebody produced a little more, then OPEC took in the accordion so that we were in balance again, and everybody was happy. The price kind of stayed high. So here comes, you know, shale oil blasting the accordion open. But now OPEC is saying, we're going to stay open, just like we're not taking it in, right? So the ones who's taking it in now, they've cut from 1,600 rigs to 540-something, while they're staying open. So this has become, but look how little of the global production of 95, you know, this is constituting, right? And they're also importing oil, as you know, 7 million barrels a day to the US. But it has been kind of a thing now between OPEC, if you want, who's staying with an open accordion, a little more than 30, and shale not cutting back, but now they are cutting back, but we have to see how quickly production comes down. An indication of what's going on is this one. This is a gas station, Chevron station in Houston, and this is a store where they sell milk. And the old normal used to be that a gallon of milk cost the same as a gallon of regular. And you know where I'm going now. Now the milk is costing the same, and a gallon is costing $1.99. So to come up with a gallon of this is costing twice as much as a gallon of this. I didn't take onshore Saudi Arabia to make the argument stronger, but this shows that oil has become a super commodity. This is not Chanel number 5 or Starbucks or Coke. This is then priced on a level with something that seems easier to get the gallon of. Don't you agree? So this is the sum of the industry right now. I call it a rhapsody in C because I play the piano. The costs are still too high. The complexity, we have organized our companies in such a complex way that they are way too expensive, the overhead. The competitiveness of the industry has been eroded. The return on capital employed now is almost less than the cost of capital. The communities where we operate correctly expect more of us. The climate change is a big issue. and E&P must be a part of the solution. We have a crashing oil price, and everybody thinks it's going to be lower for longer. And for most companies that are listed, what you see now is that they have a negative cash flow after paying dividend. They have to borrow money in the bank to pay the shareholders a dividend. So this is, you know, the space lingo in Houston. Houston, we have a problem. Coast, we have a problem getting good enough return on investment at this type of price levels. The industry is not sustainable at this low price. It costs much more on the average, apart from Saudi Arabia and a few other countries, to produce that new marginal barrel. So we have to do something. So we used to be at 110. We're down to something very uncomfortable. People are talking about what's the new normal and when do we get there. And I'm reading papers saying that we're going to stay below $40 all the way to 2020. I'm reading people who are saying we're going up to $80 per barrel in 2 months. Nobody agrees on what is the new level, but everybody agrees we're not going back to 110. We're going back to some kind of snake, maybe between 65 and 85. But the truth is nobody knows. Rex Tillerson, the CEO of ExxonMobil, just gave a talk at Oil and Money in London, and he said, I have 60 people with a PhD working on this. And based on input from them, all I can say is that the price will be between 20 and 70, but I cannot be more precise than that. I have to steer my company so I'm resilient at 20, and I have to be resilient at 70, right? That's where the price could fall in 2016. With 60 people behind it. I'm just me, so I won't even guess the price, but that's how difficult it is in this setting to predict it. You know, in the US in cowboy films, the cavalry comes in to save you. The $100 per barrel cavalry is not going to come in to save us. We have to save us ourselves. But for now, what we're doing then, of course, is to cut budgets. We cut trillions of dollars. We fired lots of people to try to get the income side to line up with the cost side, and we're tightening the belt, and every day you see headlines about people having to go. My company, Statoil, we have 22,000 employees, and last week every employee of Statoil got a letter saying, if you want to, you can leave the company now and you'll get the severance package. I have been more than 21 years with Statoil, so if I signed and handed it in, I would get more than, I think two years of salary and severance if I left the company. So that's one way of doing it, but you see in Schlumberger and Halliburton and Baker Hughes and Shell and Chevron, everybody is letting people go. So this is what we're trying to do, to live with that low oil price. And we have stopped projects, we're cutting capex because we don't have the cash flow anymore, to the tune of $1.5 trillion. And as I mentioned, 250,000 people in the E&P industry have lost their job. And just 4 years ago, we told students, please study petroleum engineering. We're going to be needing you. And now they can't get a summer job. They can't get a job. They can't get an internship. So we're kind of destroying the reputation of the industry by this boom and bust. Let's have a reality check. I told you this is not sustainable. And this is my argument. So last year, we produced 93 on the average. But we produced too much, and that too much sent the price down. But if you don't invest in any new production, then the global natural decline is between 4 and 6 million barrels per day per year. So that becomes 89, 85, 81. So by the time you get to 2020, you have lost 20 million barrels a day, right? If you didn't put any new oil on production. Then global demand is going up by, on the average, about 1 million barrels a day per year. But even if it's flat, that we had peak oil in 2015, look at the tall order. This is two Saudi Arabia, right? That's an enormous amount of oil fields to put in production to close that gap, relatively short from now. And what happened to all the projects that should fill that gap? Well, they were stopped because we can't afford it, right? So this is a tall order then to add this type of production just a little bit down the road. So this is my argument why I think it's totally unsustainable to be at 31 or 29, but I don't know when we're coming up. It's a little bit who blinks first, right? This is my friend. He runs a company. He's one of the most quoted guys now, and he is the guy who dares to say numbers on oil price, and it's so refreshing, I wanted to share it with you. He is also saying this is totally not sustainable, and we had reached 50 when he said it, now we're down to 30. And he's saying that we're going to be back to 60 at the end of this year, and then in 17 we're back to 80, and then in 2020 we're so short of oil because of the gap I just showed you, we're back to good old times up there, but we're much more efficient, right? So we have a better return on capital employed. BP is saying that we have no new economics of oil. You know, before with peak oil, where people thought we were going to run out of it, price kind of went up because it was a limited resource. I don't know anyone in the industry or outside the industry who believes we're going to be running out of oil. When we stop using oil, we have trillions of barrels left, most of us think. And that's why BP is saying there's no reason why oil prices should go up just by themselves intrinsically going forward, right? Because it's not a limited resource. We're going to stop using it and we still have trillions of barrels left. And this is, I have to agree, that's a new paradigm in our mind. But companies now are watching what, when is it going to come up? And of course, OPEC, I don't know who's the architect of keeping the accordion open and not taking it in a little bit, but they are wondering, I'm sure, behind closed doors, are we doing the right thing? Should we blink first? I'm not sure. So then I thought, how can I frame the discussion with you going forward? You know, I'm going to talk about the next 85 years. And I thought, boom and bust, I have to visit. And I have to visit stuff that can destroy both of them, you know, for some reason. First of all, you know, to do this is almost like drunk seamen. Why do we develop so much oil that all of a sudden we have so much that the price tanks? And then all of a sudden we cut back, students can't get a job, the industry looks foolish. Why can't we show more discipline over the cycle? And the reason is, of course, you can't tell 60 nations and 10,000 companies what to do, because they do what they damn please, right? So with gold and zinc and copper and you name it, oil, we seem to always be in a boom and bust cycle. We never seem to learn. It's like the philosopher Hegel, what can we learn from history? That we don't learn anything from history. And that's also the case with boom and bust. But in general, with businesses, Churchill is right. Success is never final. I used to say, I want to be Statoil like the Nokia of the oil industry. I don't say that anymore. Then I said, I want Statoil to be like the BlackBerry of the oil industry. I don't say that either. Now I say, I want Statoil to be the Apple of the oil industry, right? But how long do I say that? So we have to renew and adapt. And I'm going to try to use Harvard's big son, Mr. Porter, in the analysis of what can happen when we go forward. And many of you know his model. First, he talks about internal rivalry between the players and between groups. So this is Exxon competing with Statoil and OPEC competing with non-OPEC. Always competition, right? And then two is threat of new entrants. Can new companies come in and beat us? And number two is threat of buyers, threat of oil and gas buyers, electricity buyers. Could they possibly say, we don't want oil and gas anymore, we want electric cars, we're worried about the air. Then it's threat of suppliers, so that's steel and equipment and everything we need to develop fields onshore and offshore, including threat of suppliers of capital. And particularly now, this is a big one, because small companies that are not rated high enough cannot get the money they need. And then finally, it's threat of substitutes. What can come in and destroy this industry? Kind of the CD disc and the iTunes in terms of energy. So this is the solar, the wind, the biofuel that can knock off oil and gas, right? But there are two more forces, and I talked to Porter about this. He came to Houston and we discussed that and he liked it. So I don't know if you like it, but there are two more mega trends. But first, he lived in Edinburgh, so he knows Adam Smith, who said, the invisible hand of the market picks the winner. You don't need interference by government. The market picks the winner. This is how it should be, right? But something is happening. More and more, you see in The Guardian and big pension fund and Berkeley pension fund, they're saying we're not investing in fossil fuel anymore because of the CO2. They're pulling out. So we have a new force called threat of investors, and that's buyers of the stock in fossil fuel companies. And you've seen coal companies already erode and corrode enormously for this reason. The sovereign fund of Norway is not allowed anymore to invest in coal. And the other force number seven is then governments and international agreements picking the winner. So laws and quotas and CO2 tax and incentives, they pick the winner and not the invisible hand of the market. And I'll give you an example. In cold Norway, where I come from, very freezing, lots of long winter snow, the most selling car in Norway is the Tesla. And why is that? Is that the invisible hand of the market? No. It's because they don't pay tax, and in Norway, tax on a car is 100%. So if you buy a BMW in the US for $100,000, in Norway, that car is $200,000. If you buy a Tesla, that's still $100,000, right? So that's $100,000 difference. You drive in the HOV lane, you don't pay parking, etc., etc. So the government picked the winner, right? And more us in the oil companies feel that these are significant things. If you read the Financial Times, the chief economist, Martin Wolf, he's saying that we can't burn the reserves we have because then the CO2 content is too high to stay below the plus 2 degrees, right? So he considers a very risky investment now to invest in E&P. And this one, of course, with COP21 is upon us. So I think I have to go quicker to get through it, but internal rivalry is happening on so many things between companies. This is the same in every industry, and they are all represented, I think, on campus, internal rivalry between companies and groups. And then I have to mention that we do this in the right way. In the US now, there are 13 million people living within 1 mile of a well drilling and doing hydraulic fracturing. And they are asking, is it safe? So this is Denver. And then we say health, safety, security, environment, and social responsibility. This is number one with this company operating here. And we show them facts, and we have dialogue with the community, we have town halls, we do everything we can to get the public license to operate. And then they say, yes, you can do this. But if you don't do it right, they say, not in my backyard. And they vote you to not be allowed to do it in that county. And they're saying, no, we won't allow it, right? So this is the license to operate that we need. And if we don't maintain it, well, that's going to be a big problem for the industry. So I put it this way. We have error tolerance of zero, and health, safety, security, environment, and social responsibility is job number one. We need a public trust to get the license to operate. This I'm going to skip in the interest of time. Threat of substitutes to oil and gas. And of course, there are many. But I showed you that we just have 1.5% now for solar and geothermal and wind. But something interesting is happening. Investors are telling oil companies, I diversify, you don't. I invest in solar companies where they have 200 PhDs in photovoltaics. What do you have? Zero. You should stay with upstream and molecules. Don't get into something you know nothing about. So they violently oppose E&P companies who knows what they know to get into something they don't know. They diversify, oil companies shouldn't. And then, of course, you have this situation. This is from Beijing that we read about more and more. And I feel the general public around globally is feeling that, you know, we have to do something. And then you have the G7. They boldly say that they want to phase out fossil fuels by the end of the century. So we have 85 years to go. You follow COP, I'm sure. Pretty bold conclusion. And the conclusion is we need a lot more energy. At the same time, we need a lot less CO2. And the reason for that is that if the agreement in Paris happens, we go from this point in terms of gigatons of CO2. The Paris Agreement is still increasing CO2 up to 40 gigatons per year. And then we have spent so much of the carbon budget that in order to stay under plus 2, according to this paper, I'm not portraying to be a specialist in this, we have to all of a sudden go down to zero. Look how early, and then here we go. Forget about that one. So this is now shaping up, in my view, to be a little bit of a fight between molecules and hydrocarbon competence and long-term electrons and electricity. This is kind of the fighting that I see on the horizon between the two. And here is Mr. Thompson, who of course got the Nobel Prize for finding the electron in 1906. And he got the Nobel Prize for discovery of the photoelectric effect. So when a photon of light hits a silicon in the desert of Saudi Arabia, an electron is emitted, and here we go, right? So even Edison, I put my money on the sun and solar, what the source of power, I hope we don't have to wait until oil and coal run out. And that's a long time ago when he said that. So here we go, the shaping up of this one versus that one in this battle for the next 85 years. Threat of buyers of stock I talked about, threat of the invisible hand, not picking the winners I talked about. So what can the industry do now short term? This is a program shown on American TV called Extreme Makeover, and that's what we have to do to our industry. We have to do an extreme makeover of E&P so that we become fit again at $50 a barrel. The way we explore, the way we appraise, the way we come up with smart field developments, onshore and offshore, the way we transport it to the market, the way we generate the value by selling it, and then hopefully the stock price can go up again. So the way we have done it is not good enough. We have to do it smarter, safer, faster, cheaper, more sustainable, and in a way that the investors are saying, great, we love this industry, we want to invest more. And to do that, of course, we have to imagine a better way. Now we're back to the beginning of my talk. You can't have E&P 2.0 if you can't imagine a better way than what you're doing now. And I mentioned just a couple of things here. We have to have much more of a manufacturing mindset, mean and lean, but safe. Collaboration 2.0 between suppliers and operating companies. Much more drilling automation and smart fields. The internet of everything in the field, big data and analytics, and also many new business models. So I could talk about these 1 hour on each, but we don't have time. And in many countries, the government take is too high now, and the investor take is too low at this oil price, so that needs to be balanced as well. So I'm going to skip a lot, I think, and go to the end, because I had too much to talk about. This is funny. This is about computers taking over the role of drilling. And remember, Kasparov lost to Deep Blue in 1997, and then Kasparov beats Deep Blue in one move, right, by hitting off. Yeah. And then you have Watson that beat the two Jeopardy champions, right? So I'll skip Moore's Law and the Flintstones. Let's see. So he then got a patent on this car 122 years ago. So this was kind of 1.0. If you look at pictures, maybe even of Jeddah in 1850, look at all those horses, right? It's unbelievable. There are horses everywhere, no cars, of course. And then just a little bit later, there are cars everywhere, a little funny looking, but there they are. And then my daughter lives in New York, and it looks like this. So transitions all the time. And then here is the Tesla, and he erased, you know, how to make an engine out of electricity. And what's he saying? In 20 years, to own a normal car requires that needs a driver would be like owning a horse. You only have it for sentimental reasons, right? And here is this, you don't even drive, you just sit there. And in the UK now, they're building roads, as you know, where the battery of your car is being charged electromagnetically while you're driving there. So you don't have to go home and charge it. It's happening while you are driving. Here's my friend again sticking his neck out. Within 45 years, and that is equal to 3 car generations, so in 2061, we'll all be driving electric cars, and this is consistent then also, he feels, after working on it, by staying below plus 2 degrees Celsius. So in history, we have the Iron Age and the Stone Age and this age and that age. In the US, you know, the oil industry started in Pennsylvania. We go up to some point where we have a peak. It doesn't matter when, kind of who cares. At one point, we come down and we don't use. So we just have another age in history called the oil age. And as I said before, I'm not worried for a second for the reason I told you earlier. We're going to come up with the energy we do. Many have modeled how quickly this happens. This is a bunch of models then showing how we stop using oil. This is kind of a central tendency curve. And I picked the one by Scientific American. They're saying that we reached peak 2 years ago, so they were slightly off. They think that in 85 years, we don't use oil very much, or 86 from that point. And then we didn't stop using oil because we ran out of it. No, we had billions of barrels left, trillions of barrels left, like we didn't end the Stone Age because we didn't stop sailing because we ran out of stone. It ended because it'd be too expensive. Alternatives are much more attractive and convenient. And maybe, I say maybe, climate issues made it imperative. So even the toughest people who say that it's just a bunch of loony scientists who believe in a climate having a relationship to what man does, even they say, okay, there could be a relationship. But then there is a surprising upside in endings, right? Because when we don't do this, we do something else. And Saudi Arabia, with all this sun and all this sand and silicon, I think there was a talk last night about you can be a new superpower with another one, you know, taking over for this one. So 84 more years to go. So what we have to learn then is to, in our minds, agree that we need a lot more oil, what I call near long term, but very far long term, we have to kind of plant the tree and fund it and do Manhattan projects and R&D until that's ready to take over in many decades from now. But we have to kind of have these two in our minds at the same time. Skip that one and look at Saudi Arabia, right? This is outstanding, and you know that because you live here in the summer. I visited in the summer. This is going to be a superpower, I predict, down the road, with sun that is taking over. So the takeaway from me then is that no one can predict the forward oil price, including Rex Tillerson with Exxon, with 60 PhDs looking at it. We will see more boom and bust periods. Oil and gas will be needed for many decades to come. We have to navigate success in 4E, as I mentioned. E&P 2.0 is an imperative. We're not competitive the way we do it now. And E&P is a village with many people living in the village, and all of them must contribute. Imagination is king. We need incremental and radical improvements constantly. And the invisible hand of the market, Adam Smith, seems to less and less pick the winners. Governments and international agreements seem to come in much stronger. Dot collectors, students, professors, whoever, I think they will experience much more serendipity that leads to great ideas than those who just stay within their tribe. Kudos to you for running the winter series to have strange people even like me. And I think the fittest are going to be the best collaborators globally with other universities, with other tribes. So with that, I don't think we're going to listen to this song, which has "If Man Is Still Alive." I think we're going to listen to this song. So with that, I got to the end. Thank you so much for your attention.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself.
Well, thank you, Helge, for a wonderful talk. I think we have time for a few questions, but please make them questions, not statements. Anybody willing to ask questions? I can't see very well from here.
Wonderful talk, thank you. I was wondering, so earlier this year, Google restructured itself into Alphabet so it could diversify. And you mentioned that the investors don't want oil and gas to diversify. Is restructuring a potential for that to allow investment in clean energy?
Right. Remember the Porter model had this force called threat of new entrants? I think now as we go to including more and more of solar and other types of hybrid systems, I think maybe the likes of Facebook and Google and Amazon, maybe they're going to be the new type of companies that comes in with new types of energy, so that what, you know, the derogatory term is big oil. You heard the term big oil, right? That's Exxon and Total and Shell and Statoil. Many people think that big oil in say 60 years is not going to be big new energy. That the new big new energy companies, and then that's not going to be a derogatory term anymore, that could be the likes of Google and Amazon and what have you, right? Because they don't have that old DNA, they don't only have PhDs with focusing on molecules and oil and gas and flow and porous media. So I think, but Exxon I think feels that the minute this takes off and becomes important, they just buy them. They just buy that company, and all of a sudden you have Exxon photovoltaics, and you have Exxon, you know, oil and gas. And look at GE, you know, some people say that conglomerates are bad. They have TV stations. I mean, there's something they don't, they do everything under the sun. So I think there's a debate going about the value of focusing on one thing versus the value of a conglomerate. Because if you have sinus in one business and cosinus in the other, that could be a nice mitigation of risk, right, if they're not in phase. But of course, if they're both kind of horrible at the same time, that's not a good diversification. So I know many PhDs are looking at this now in terms of economics and risk and what have you. So that's a great question. But sorry, I have such a lousy answer.
You mentioned that you do like renewable energy, but how do you like them?
I like it because if you looked at the picture from Beijing, right? You don't want it to be like that for your children, but they need the power at the same time, right? Because that lifts people out of poverty. So I have a personal passion about sustainable oil and gas production. That means that we always try to make it safer, more secure, lower the CO2 emitted per barrel produced, so that we become kind of more and more a part of the solution. But more than anything, I feel that you need oil and gas to fund the Manhattan projects that's going to make renewable viable and commercially viable. But there's nothing in me that kind of, I don't feel a threat really as a professional in oil and gas with solar, wind and biofuel. I feel we need all of the above. In addition to the people I mentioned, there's 1.3 billion people without access to electricity. There's 2.4 million people a year dying from the fumes because they cook inside, right? They don't have access to it. So I think we need all of the types that I'm talking about. I'm supportive of taking one down because the next one comes up. But, you know, my education has been in molecules, slow and porous media, and I'm not at the end of my career, but it's hard for me maybe to go into it. I don't understand it enough, I'm sure. I know photoelectricity, but when I say I'm positive to it, it has to do with the caretaking of the planet. When you send an astronaut in space and they look back on planet Earth, regardless of party they come from, Republican or Democrat, they all feel like we have to take care of this beautiful planet. So maybe I feel like an astronaut up in space looking back at this beautiful place. Let's keep it beautiful. So if that means oil and gas, the best we can until solar and the rest is ready, that's how I think about it in a way, that we have to fund the development of the other.
In your analysis, you're saying that the oil and gas consumption will be quite small by 2100. And part of the one of the reasons you said was because the price was going to be very high. But you said also that there's lots of it. So I don't quite understand that logic. And then I also detected some, you know, doubting in your voice when you were talking about the fact that we might need to stop burning some of this stuff because of the impact on the planet.
Right.
So could you just revisit those two?
Let's start with the last one. So if you look at what they now call the carbon budget, I can't remember the numbers because it's not quite my field, right? But if you go from 2011, I think you can emit 1,100 gigatons and still stay below 2 degrees. Okay, so from 2011 to a point where you have sent up 1,100 gigatons, then you cannot send up more because then you will go over 2 degrees, right? So that green line I showed you with the Paris Agreement, with all the promises from 123 nations, that is that green line that goes to 40 in 2035, I can't remember. And then you have used 700 of those 1,100. So you have just that little left, right? So if you want to be true to the argument then, you have to speedily get down to zero emission of CO2, because then you spent those 1,100. So I'm just basing that on those who model and study the field. I haven't myself gone in and I don't have the competence for it either. But that's the argument then around, you know, how quickly we have to come up with something else if you believe those numbers. Ted, you study it more closely, but there are probably other numbers, but 1,100 gigatons from 2011 is what I read, and that Paris is going to give 750, and then we have so little left that we have to hurry with CCS and all the rest of it.
But you're doubting these analyses?
No, I'm not doubting it. I'm just using it kind of as an argument that this is something that people around the globe is trying to understand and watching and maybe believing more than before, right? So they get that sense of urgency. Victor Hugo, he said that nothing is stronger than an idea whose time has come. And if you look at the Renaissance and the epochs of history, what changed the way we talk, the way we discuss something, take us from one epoch to another, right? And that could happen with this issue. I gave just three alternatives. It could be, maybe something happened environmentally with the poles, Antarctica or something. That everybody agrees that it is now an imperative to do something. We really have to quickly do something else. So then we get Manhattan projects and billions in New Mexico, you know what I mean? And all of a sudden you speed up, you know, the cutting of cost and commerciality of many forms of new energy. So the cost is because it's getting more and more costly, even if you have shale now. If you look at when will shale, kind of, at least in the US, come to a halt, where all the sweet spots are drilled up, it varies, but 2025, 2027, people feel that that's going to be petering out. But then maybe Argentina and China and other countries come. But so far, people are saying that rocks are not created equal. They're not seeing this type of quality that you see in Bakken, Marcellus, Eagle Ford, and the Permian. They haven't seen this type of shales kind of anywhere, maybe except the Vaca Muerta in Argentina. So then you're left with very deep stuff and Arctic oil, and then you're up to, right, break even, you know, it costs maybe $110 a barrel to get it up. And people and by that time, renewables is much cheaper. You have a Moore's law and price going down. So that was kind of the background for those points. Yeah.
Good evening. Thank you for this very interesting talk. I have a very short question. What is the cost of electricity from solar today?
You know, I'm not sure. I don't think you yet have what they call grid parity, meaning that in Arizona, Texas, middle of Australia, that you get the same price as you get if you just buy it from the grid. But I do know it's coming down pretty fast, isn't it, Ted? But that is the key cost. The consumers buy it when it's cheap enough. So I agree. This is the key.
My question was
Germany, where the market penetration is the highest, and the cost of electricity is also the highest in Europe. However, it's coming down.
Yeah, so sure, I know. But my question was linked to the fact that I wanted to know why you say that solar is not ready, because we are below grid parity. We are cheaper than the cost of traditional power generation.
Yeah, but then I think that should competitively win in that marketplace. And I would be all for it. And maybe then it has to do with the government coming in with the right incentives to make it happen, rather than maybe blocking it with a lobby. I'm not sure.
I think that we may continue at a glass of water or juice. And let's thank Helge for a wonderful talk.
Thank you very much. Thank you.